Hey DJ, just play that song, keep on scratching all night. Hey DJ, just play that song, you have me itching all night.
For the next 10 weeks, we will discuss a different element of hip-hop culture. Those elements being the DJ, the MC, breaking, graffiti art, street knowledge, beatboxing, street fashion, street language, and street entrepreneurialism. For the first time, we will bring experts to discuss and define each element of hip-hop culture. On the line with us, we have Mr. Tony Shellman.
How you doing?
Good. Welcome to the Keith Tucker Show.
Hey, thanks for being here, man. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for coming, man. Hey, so really just want to really get into it, man. Me and you have been knowing each other for many years.
But
and people need to know that you are born and raised in Seattle, and you're from Seattle, and you went out and had very successful career. Tell the people a little bit about yourself and how you got started in fashion.
I'm from Seattle. Originally, I got started in fashion by working at a small store in Seattle called Nordstrom. And it's been pretty fun. You know, that was great. I got to work with Pete Nordstrom, the life of Pete Nordstrom, in his shoe department at times. And I kind of, you know, my friends, you know, my neighbors were the ones that kind of got me in fashion. The guy named Terry O'Neill was like, one day he asked me, yo, does this look hot? I was like, oh, that's hot.
Yeah.
And then, you know, we started getting focused on what to wear and what jeans to wear, and we became like the fat people in the neighborhood.
Right.
And, you know, I just kind of kept on going with it. I just kept on wearing different fashions. So I guess from there I became the fashion guy.
So, you know, from Nordstrom's, from Nordstrom's, did you go to the Zebra Club after Nordstrom's?
Yeah, Nordstrom's, I went straight to the Zebra Club.
Okay.
I went to the Zebra Club and became their number one guy in sales, and you know, kind of grew from there. Blew that up.
Right.
They kind of just so they let me manage one of the stores. They let me manage the store, the new store, that new special store they had, which was in the mall. So what's the thing called now? It's I forgot what it's called.
Is it in South Center Mall?
No, not South Center, but
Westlake. Westlake.
Yeah, Westlake. Yeah.
Okay.
So that was new. So they let me manage Westlake.
Okay.
So I took that project on, took the Westlake project on, and from there, you know, I was able to do some pretty big things from there.
Okay.
With the Westlake project, so that was a big thing. That was a specialty store that they came out with, and you know, I was able to manage that and do cool things with that. So that kind of gave me my shot. So the people in Zebra Club really gave me, that kind of really gave me a shot, those people.
Yeah. You know, and it was, I could kind of see a progression of your learning as you go through every position that you took, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm. So once you took that job at Westlake, then what made you decide to go to New York, Tony?
You know what? When I took the job at Westlake, kind of what happened was I was at Westlake, and I kind of was going to school, going to college at Shoreline Community College. And
what was you taking at Shoreline?
Textile and fashion merchandising.
There you go. Okay.
Yeah, and what happened was a lady named Carolyn Blunt, who was the head of that program, the chair of that program, kind of was like, look, fashion, you're pretty good at fashion. At the time, I was going to Zebra Club. And she was like, you know, there's a really cool school in New York called Parsons School of Design.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, okay, who the heck is Parsons?
Right.
And so I made fun of it. And she goes, well, let's see. Some of the great designers in fashion today went there. And, of course, one of my mentors and idols is Ralph Lauren.
Right,
you know?
Right.
So Ralph Lauren went to school there. Bill Blass went to school there. Donna Karen. Let's see. Wookie Rodriguez went to school there.
Wow.
Of course, what's my man's name? I'm losing my mind today. I can't think of my people there. That would be, what's wrong with me? Came out with the unconstructed suit. That would be not Wookie Rodriguez, but Willie Smith, was Willie Wear.
Okay.
Yeah, so when you have those, Willie's like one of the top first big designers for African-Americans.
Right.
So to be able to wear his stuff when I was younger and then to go to that school, it was a great thing for me. And again, you know, like Byron Lear, Byron Lahr, I mean, people like that went to school at Parsons. So I mean, you know, Bob Mackey.
Wow.
You know, the school, you know, the greats went to that school. You know, Giorgio Armani went to Parsons. I mean, the great designers went to Parsons. So to be a part of that school, I got, you know, I got into school. But the cool thing about that school was for me, Keith, was when I went there, I was interviewed and got accepted into the school by this guy named Tim Gunn.
Uh-huh.
Tim Gunn has a small show on TV called Project Runway, and now he has his own shows on TV now, big-time star now.
Okay.
But he's the guy that discovered me to put me in the school.
Wow.
So he's the one that was like, look, I came to school for the interview, and he was the one that, you know, accepted me on the spot, and I got into school in the top 5% of my class.
Wow. That's amazing,
yeah,
man.
So I was lucky, fortunate, and, you know, a lot of people, you know, I owe that credit of learning and having all that knowledge to a lot of people in Seattle.
Yeah.
Like I said, the Pete Norsons of the world were really good to me.
Mm-hmm.
The Michael Escos, Amit Shah, the Shah family in general.
Right.
I mean, a lot of people were showing me support. And, of course, you know, I was very blessed. My community, of course, embraced me and made sure that when things were tough or things I wasn't sure, my community carried me. So,
yeah.
You know, I'm very lucky. The black community in Seattle really took good care of me.
Wow, that's cool. I know this definition has probably changed throughout your career, but what does street fashion mean to you right now? What is street fashion?
Well, street fashion is, you figure, urban is the street,
mm-hmm.
is what it stands for.
Yeah.
You know, the urban cities, like a New York City, or like a downtown Seattle, that's the urban life.
Right.
That's the urban city, and the street comes from the fashions that were in urban life to be able to function. Like when you said, like when you think about New York, the gang of New York and the way everybody used to dress back then, that was different from being on the farm in the rural areas. So
right.
Urban street fashion, even today, it's a different utilitarian type of an issue because, you know, you have to have pockets and knapsacks and you're out on the streets and you're out, you're not at home. And so the fashions reflect ergonomics.
Right.
I don't mean urbanomics, ergonomics.
Okay.
So it reflects that. So streetwear is like, you know, from being able to, like I said, from the weather to the, like I said, the utilitarian perspective of how that pocket makes sense to have it inside pocket types and stuff like that. And then, of course, the flair of street fashion because things are done so fast.
Mm-hmm.
And so it has a lot of flair and because people are quick to make things and put things together. So for us, street fashion is a combination of just people that work together from kids to just designers, just the whole essence of the streets of urban streets, and that's where we get the street fashion.
Tony, how do you think hip-hop has influenced the fashion industry? What's the influence there, the whole industry?
I think hip-hop has influenced the fashion industry from the simple perspective of kids, in order to be able to be break dancers or to be rappers, like rock bands, had to come up with outfits.
Right.
You know, of course, there was no costume director for Kumo D,
right.
You know, and Kool Herc and people like that, you know, or, you know, Fabulous Four plus, I call it the Fabulous Four, but it's really the Funky Four plus one more.
Yeah, we had Shaw Rock on here.
Yeah, exactly. There was no stylist. So we, once again, the street fashions and our own creativity, we created our own fashion.
Right.
So with street fashions, you know, from the Lee jeans or someone, you know, being out in Seattle to, you know, Levi's and Vans.
Right.
You know, you create your own fashions, and that's kind of how it got going. You made do with what you had.
Right.
You know, if there was inspiration from you know, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five with their whole space look or the ethnic look from African Bambaataa, you know, all the different influences to just, once again, the ergonomic feeling of being on the streets where, you know, your Lee jeans with your Pumas. You know,
right.
That was street fashion. So, you know, hip-hop has influenced not just fashion, but at the end of the day, a culture.
Right.
You know? And now when you hear a McDonald's commercial or you see, you know, all these different commercials, all these different things going on with street fashions involved, it's pretty amazing. It's pretty amazing.
This is Miles, and we're taking a break, and we'll be back with the King Tucker Show.
Yeah, of love, brown sugar, about to set it light. Yeah, yeah, yo, yeah, yeah, yo, yeah, yeah, yo. Adjust my mic so I can touch it up right quick. Show me how Brooklyn do, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Listen, yo, let's start it up. Let's get it flowing. Let's make a move. Let's get it going. I know it's feeling like everything you want, don't it? And you've been waiting your whole life for one moment. Well, baby, here it is. You better step to it.